chill. Isn't this how the best of it should be? Taking the body to the point at which it almost breaks, and then returning, having had your faith restored in the miraculous fragility of the self. The night I almost ended us, it was your sobbing brought me back. We talked ourselves together, and the next day, still wearing your hand around my neck, I found I was struggling to swallow. Every mouthful was a labour. I became aware of the mechanics of my own body, could feel parts of myself that would usually go unnoticed. After your hand had been on my throat, I learned the pleasure in possessing capacities that are never quite fulfilled, almost being broken, almost leaving, but deciding to tuck it out. A lot of the books in physical deal with ideas of masculinity and kind of what it means to be a man, I think, in the 21st century. Or that's what I was kind of interested in as I was writing them. And it seemed to me that if you want to understand what's happened to masculinity in the 21st century, you want to go and watch straight men attempt to interact with each other in a gym. And that kind of awkward ballet that they kind of do, because they can't do it. And so I wrote this poem that was just called "The Men Are Weeping in the Gym." The men are weeping in the gym, using the hand dryer to cover their sobs. Their hearts have grown too big for their chests. Their chests have grown too big for their shirts. They are dressed like kids who have forgotten their games kits. They are crying in the toilet, and because they have built themselves as statues, this must mean that God has entered them. They are wringing their faces like sweat towels in the sink. Their veins are about to burst their banks. They are flooding out of themselves onto the tiles. They have turned water into protein shakes. They have got too close to the mirrors. They have got too close to the glass. And now they are laying in the broken pools of their own faces. The lines of them, that the decline press, the bicep curl, waiting, staring straight ahead, swearing that the wetness on their cheeks is perspiration, that the words they mutter as they lift are meaningless, that they feel nothing when the muscle tears itself from itself, that they don't hear the thousands of tiny fracturings needed to build something stronger. I'll stick with the exercise theme for a little bit and then do something else. I've only ever done yoga once, and rather than enlightenment, I got a poem, which is maybe the next best thing. So this is just called Yoga. We are told to tell our bodies that they are beautiful. We are told not to pass judgment on where the breath may fall. In the dry heat of July, we bend our bodies beyond their normal boundaries, push past the bones until we look like unkempt foliage, delirious in our own abandon. We are told to root our feet into the ground. We are told to hear all sounds around us as vibrations. We have forgotten that the body can hold on to negativity. We are told to sigh this out. We are told that only empty things are light enough to fly. We end by flying, hoisting up our partners by our feet, taking the weight on our forearms on the ground. The flyer feels bodiless until a heft begins to shake the legs and the architecture of the limbs collapses. It needs trust in the strength of body of another to support your own, to delay and then control the falling. Later, showered, fed and still too warm, stretched out on the mattress in the new flat, nothing but dust on the bare walls. You press me down, took control, took me in your mouth. I regret now being so passive, but you made me feel weightless. And the next night, light gone in the hallway, I felt my way to you, to kiss you. I'd forgotten that loving could feel so calming, telling you that your body was beautiful, sighing out the brittle disappointments of the bones, having no judgment of what the body may want to be doing, where the breath may fall. I'll do one more exercise, but, and then we can all relax and I'll do something else. I've got a nephew who's now 11 or 12, and always just been the kind of smartest kid in the world, and any uncle I guess would say that, but I remember he's always been one of those lads who has kind of listened and repeated back anything anyone's ever said kind of around him. So when he was 6, he came in and went, "Oh mother, you go from the sublime to the ridiculous." A great thing, as I should say. And this is just a poem about something he once asked me when I think he was sort of maybe 8 or 9, just called Strong Man. My nephew asks if I can bench press him. His mother's new lover can and often does. My nephew, who once said my boyfriend was illegal. My nephew with his dad's voice and jaw. My nephew, who now protests I had my hand on his balls for the first attempt. I try again, let both his wicked legs rest against one palm, put my other to his heart and push. Because what is masculinity, if not taking the weight of a boy and straining it from oneself? Here we are, a man holding a boy above him, horizontal like an offering to the architect's ceiling. Not even a minor Greek would see us fit to sculpt. It's a really nice and kind of generous introduction, and kind of like, it's took me by surprise kind of how kind of well received the book's been and how nice people have been about it. And I was thinking, those kind of situations, it's nice to keep your feet on the ground. And so what I like to do is read bad reviews of the book. And there's a great one by someone that we won't name, Alan Dent, who said, he said, whilst the book may prove popular amongst the homosexual community, it won't be for the pummels. He also suggested this next point might be a poem, and I hope it is. It's called Just Because I Do This Doesn't Mean. Not knowing names doesn't make it something less. The mid-road fight or the red jumper and bike doesn't make it something more. It was just a long walk through seesaw streets. A stomach stretched tight as drum skin of a hollow abdomen. Mouths finding every part of one another. Watching the mirror like a laptop screen. A moon that kept trying to light us but kept off. A flat full of short flight stopover. The one who wanted to pretend he was wrestling. To be pinned under the anxious face of the clock. Watching the kisses that wanted to stay for longer than night. The one who said he wanted to write. The way an old woman in slippers might say she used to want to be a dancer. The heavy scent of them as they showered and I dressed. Running until I was breathless in the centre of town. It wasn't the rain. The rain hadn't come yet. But it would. When I was putting the book together, a lot of the poems, there's kind of two kind of made relationships and kind of breakups from those, I guess, in looking back. But it seemed to me that there needed to be a poem for the people they hadn't quite worked out with. And I think everyone's got these people in their lives where you think, oh, if it had fallen slightly differently, if the tide had landed slightly differently, it might be them. Something might have happened with them. And so I felt like they deserved the poem as well, and so this is just for them, called a gift. A gift for the ones I never touched, for the ones who wanted to watch films, who wanted to talk, who wanted silence and said I talk too much, for the one I saw weeks after laughing, for the one who served me coffee and didn't recognise my hands, for the optimistic ones who write their names on toilet walls, the ones I never called, for the ones I called who didn't answer, who left our love suspended from the ceiling hooks of that meat market city, for the ones who left and settled down, the ones who wanted knowledge, were curious, who gained something from each encounter, used each other, who took what they needed, for everyone they hurt, who felt burned out, the ones who didn't realise everyone was burning, the ones who never slept, who died nightly, the ones who said they'd kill for it, for all of them, a gift. We were young, we only had our bodies. There's a long poem in the middle of the book that I'm not going to read, because that's the death knell of any poetry reading, isn't it, if someone goes. I'd now like to read you my 30-page poem with no breaks. But I'll spare you, but it's because I still am obsessed by how, by an individual, which is why I've got to read on me as well, because I'm just that kind of guy. This long poem in the middle, I've been walking around saying that I thought it was like Howl, if Howl had been set in Barnsley. It might have looked something like this long poem. And then there's this great critic that came along and said, it's nothing like Howl, it's just a series of homosexual encounters, not all of them successful. Which is probably A, going to be on my tombstone, but I think also just a nice way to think about the book in general, that could like be its tagline. I mentioned Barnsley, I'm actually from a little village just outside, which is kind of forgotten by history, except that when Margaret Thatcher died, it was the village that was on the national news because people were dressed as miners, drinking beer and burning Margaret Thatcher, which were left. Which is great, but I just thought people in the south probably thought that's what it's like every day. The cameras just happened to come past them and any day, it wasn't like a special thing. And I mentioned that just because this poem kind of set the day after Margaret Thatcher died, and also has kind of in its background that great phrase of hers, the lady's not for turning. So it's just called the small boys. Coming with the bulge of them through the doors, schoolboys in suits so big it seems as though grown men have deflated inside. Two slunk away from the morning rush of bags, phones, arms stretched out with their muscle by the sharp sprints of growth. They find their seats and settle, facing first bluff ready for shaving but left to go feral above the lip. Words sweating into the air between them, the 12-year-old talk that finds the body still comical rather than alluring. They briefly mention Thatcher and the town that came together for a party they didn't understand the point of, although the adults seem to enjoy it, drinking and setting fire to a doll of her. One makes a joke insult to the other, who pretends to be offended, pouting into his rucksack, then out the window, the silence. But they are still only learning stubbornness and buckle quickly. The insulter takes his friend's face in one hand, pushing his thin lips together to parody the mood. The lady sat by the side of me tucked. The boys let go and start their conversation up again. One puts his hand between the cheap trousers of the other, the way small girls often hold hands on their way to class. The woman coughs and sighs like a slow punch of football. She stares out the window, maybe thinking of her son, by now a man. She goes red. She focuses on a headline, rising unemployment, lack of manual jobs. The boys move seats. Two others wrestle to impress the girls. The boys sit closer than they needed to. The lady burns. As was also said in the introduction, I teach great writing up in Liverpool, but prefer Manchester, but don't tell them that. But one of the things I always say to students is, if you need a good title for a poem, you look through the Bible and point to any phrase, and it just gives you a great gift of a title for any poem that you might be writing. And so I have a poem when I first started out called His Meat Was Locusts and Wild Honey. Great title. Matthew 3:4, for the biblical scholars amongst us. And so I thought, if it worked with the Bible, maybe it worked with other song titles. And so I Wikipedia'd up all the hits of ABBA and found this kind of great forgotten classic called If It Wasn't for the Knives. And that's nothing to do with this poem, but I just like that title. And so I stole it. So this poem was just called If It Wasn't for the Knives. I tour my foreign voice through the tin-roofed halls of semi-rural provinces. I barely understand the lines, but the crowd goes mad, and claps of thunder thrum the valley where I sleep. And my lonely haircut chest eyes the bar between us, and I gather salt and sleep alone. And back across the border, the man I love is curled to someone else, and they don't speak a word. And outside, a precious bird doesn't comprehend the language of its wings, and frost hums on the weather vane. If it wasn't for the nights, Stefan, I'd come home. Things men take. The room above the ceiling, the better pay, the jobs, your space at the bar, the piss, the smell of piss when they leave a room, the silence, the short road out and the long road home, the swelling they seem to want to break the walls with, or they take so much, it's easier to list what it is they leave behind. Or they take without asking, like the man who takes the image of the blonde-haired girl in the low-cut top, goes home and takes his trousers off, takes a picture of the girl from the back of his mind, takes his wife in an almost pleasant way, then takes his face over to the wall, takes more than half the duvet, dreams of the short road out and the long road home, dreams of taking everything in the house into his hands, dreams his hands are much bigger than they are. Let's do three more poems. This one, based on the myth of Leda and the swan. So Zeus, kind of disguised as a swan, comes down to earth and seduces, but really rather rapes Leda. And so this is just Leda to her daughters. I feel battered. He put the thing his species talks with up inside me, and he talked. Daughter, the moment when he opens out and stretches is when he looks most beautiful. The moment when he looks most beautiful is the moment right before he breaks your arm. Daughter, on his own he's only heart for heart. Daughter, he made me his pen. He made me do the messy things he keeps beneath the surface. Daughter, his feet. His eyes were hungry for the sky. When he came, he made a sound that still hatches in my throat each morning. How typical of a man, daughter, to pretend he didn't understand, to think my outstretched hand might be an offering of food, daughter, to think that I would feed him. It's real, I'll just come back to quote some players and read, and it was kind of 4 years ago when I was just starting out that I read them downstairs in the kind of long space down there. And just to kind of be able to hear music and then poetry, I always just think is a fantastic kind of privilege. And it's a joy just kind of being able to sit and listen as well. But I don't know about you, but after I've sat for a while at any kind of event like this, there's always a feeling that comes over me. And that feeling gives this next poem its title. It's called Urination. That's nice to find a level of the room. Or as my mum's now taken to calling me, Andrew, please don't meet that one again. I'm scared of bumping someone while they piss. Those Mondays I'm a pack horse, bags hung, swinging around the urinal bodies, and one day I know I'll knock someone and they'll piss their legs, or they'll turn slightly and show another man their full arm, or they'll fall into their own wet puddle, cock, limp, and neither of us will look, or he'll look at me, avoiding looking, feigning interest in the hard creamy tiles. Maybe it's that I dream of being bumped, not from my aim by a stranger, the briefest touch during the private act. The toilet is an intimacy only shared with parents when you were young, and once again when they are older, and with lovers, when, say, on a Sunday, morning stretching into the bathroom, you wake to a sound of stream into bowl, and go to hug the naked body stood with its back to you, and kiss the neck, and taste the whole of the night on there, and smell the morning's pale yellow moss, and take the whole of him in your hand, and feel the water moving through him, and knowing that this is love, the prune flesh, what we expel from the body and what we let inside. When I read that poem in Liverpool, a bloke came up to me afterwards and said, that poem's made me realise we've got a hobby in common. He was mistaken, I don't want to get the wrong impression. It's been a real pleasure, and thanks for coming out on a kind of wet and windy and snowy and wild and Lord knows what else night. But I'll finish off with this last poem called Finally. Finally, a day will come when, woken by the xylophone of sun through blinds, you'll realise that the beach was not the place where horses tore the sand to ribbon, that the scent of him has lifted from the last of the sheets, that he isn't coming back, that it hasn't rained, that the birds are pretending that it has, so they can sing. Thank you very much.